Hey everybody, it's Dr. Karen, and I wanted to pop in and share something that is going to give you massive clarity if you have ever struggled to make consistent progress in language therapy without spending hours digging through tons of therapy materials, research, and without second guessing yourself. Because a lot of the SLPs that I mentor really struggle with these things. So that's why in this video, I am going to share with you some principles that I use to consistently get my students to their least restrictive environment, position myself as a language therapy expert so that I can walk into sessions more confident, and also what I've been able to use, the system that I've been able to use to get great results in therapy, which has helped me to leverage my expertise to actually advance in my career. So let's get started. So if you are an SLP treating pediatric language disorders, you probably have found that you are feeling like there are a lot of different skills that you need to target for your students because they have so many different skills that they can't do. You might be working on main idea, supporting details, summarizing and retelling, and WH questions, and pronouns, and verb tenses, and categorization, and the list kind of goes on and on. It can be really difficult to figure out which of these things are the highest priority, which things are going to give us the biggest bang for our buck, and which skills are actually going to result in generalization. A lot of times it can feel like we're kind of just jumping around from skill to skill without any clear system. And that can be really stressful, as you've probably already realized. And when I first started out, I felt like I was always spreading myself very thin and confusing my students, and was really frustrated because a lot of times when I would get to writing my goal updates, I found that students didn't really make consistent progress, and I was starting to really question myself as a professional. So I had to really stop and ask myself some difficult questions. So I had to ask myself, what if I cut through all of this clutter and figured out how to narrow down just a couple key strategies and a couple key skills that I could focus on, maybe even one key area that would make all of the difference? And what if instead of jumping around from skill to skill and always overwhelming myself and my students, if I focused on less and not more and just forgot about the other stuff? Would this be possible and what would happen? Well, what I found was that when I actually looked at a lot of the patterns for my students with language disorders, and when I started to do my doctoral research and look at some key skills that actually could predict reading comprehension and that were actually necessary for students to succeed in school, especially students with language disorders. So looking at those skills that tend to hold them back if they're not addressed directly, what I started to find is that there were actually just a couple key skills that were the highest priority for me as an SLP. And when I actually started applying this to my language therapy, I found that a lot of the students that I was working with, when I focused on less, not more, a lot of the students that had plateaued actually were able to finally start making some consistent progress and get to their least restrictive environment. So I had one student who came in first grade, and by third grade, I was able to dismiss him. He was one of those speech and language only students. So I was able to get him to the point that he didn't need an IEP, while other students, maybe they were needing a lot of special education services in the early years, and they still needed special ed, but we got to the point where maybe they were in the classroom more. So instead of being in a self-contained setting, they were able to be more independent in the general education classroom with support. So the greatest part was that I actually saw my students making progress. When the students were being dismissed from speech, it was because they were better, not because we'd simply given up. So let me get to the principles. So the first principle is that with language therapy, even though it feels like we have all of this stuff and we have to do all the things, you actually will make a bigger impact on your students if you adopt the less is more principle. Now, a lot of people assume that in order to help a student improve on a skill, you have to target it directly, but that's actually not necessarily true, which is a good thing for language because there are a lot of different language skills. all of the language skills that you could be targeting. I know there's a lot of pronouns, flashcards, verb tense worksheets, and things like that. Not all of those things are the highest priority. You don't actually have to work on all of the things for your students to work on all of the things. And the thing is that when we actually look at the cause of the problem, not the symptom, we can actually make a bigger impact. So let's look at what some of those things are and some of the patterns that I found in my research and in my clinical practice. So first, we know that direct instruction of specific skills and concepts work. It works, especially when it comes to vocabulary and language growth. We know that children are able to retain vocabulary concepts better when we're given direct explanations of vocabulary words. We also know that a lot of our students who are on our caseloads have very weak vocabulary skills. The problem is that there are a lot of different words that your students might need to know. And we know that a lot of our students are way, way behind when it comes to language. Now, the reason that I'm pinpointing vocabulary is because if you actually look at vocabulary across the years, when you look at kids in the early grades, like second grade, and then look at the kids in high school, the kids that are still struggling in high school are the ones that have that weak vocabulary knowledge. And the other thing is that if we don't understand 90 to 95% of the words in texts that we are reading, then we're not going to comprehend them. So that means that those students read less, which means that they are exposed to fewer words. And it also means that they are going to have a hard time comprehending what they're reading. So a lot of times we're jumping to those high level comprehension strategies before our students have that vocabulary foundation that they need in order to have good comprehension. Same thing goes for sentence structure. A lot of times our students are really struggling with the structure of sentences. So we're working on all of these comprehension strategies with our students, but they can't even understand words and sentences. And those skills that we can target all go back to our word knowledge and our knowledge of how words function within sentences, which has to do with our word and sentence level comprehension. So the problem is that if we don't have that base level comprehension, we're not going to be able to get the big picture. So a lot of us are scrambling around trying to work on inferencing and problem solving, all of these things before our kids actually have a foundation. So we can actually make a bigger impact by focusing on that word and sentence level knowledge, which ties back to vocabulary. And I'll explain a little bit about why vocabulary has to do with sentence level comprehension in just a minute here. But the problem with vocabulary instruction, as I was saying before, is that we know that direct instruction works, but you can't teach every single word and sentence structure your students don't know. There's just not enough time. So what we need to do is, instead of trying to teach everything and trying to get through, you know, this many word lists or whatever and figure out, do my kids know these vocabulary words for this test, we need to figure out which skills are the highest priority and focus more on the process of learning words so that our kids can apply that to other situations rather than trying to teach our students everything. We need to figure out which skills are going to teach our students to learn other skills beyond therapy. So that's why we can actually focus on just a few key concepts that will enable you to do that instead of trying to teach everything, because teaching everything is just not going to be possible. So how do we actually do that? Well, that goes to principle number two. So principle number one was less is more. We've got to figure out how to prioritize. And the way that we figure out how to prioritize is by knocking down the first domino. So think about how dominoes work. If you knock down the first one, you don't actually have to touch the other ones, because doing something over here to the first one is going to knock down other things and actually result in the other dominoes being knocked down on their own. So what we have consistently found is, again, when we improve comprehension at the word and sentence level, what that can do is free up cognitive resources for high level comprehension. Yes, do we need to sometimes tie it together and work on some comprehension strategies for our students? Of course, some of the time, but we don't need to start there because our kids aren't even ready for it yet. And they're getting a lot of that in the general education curriculum. So you don't necessarily need to spend your precious language therapy time on those high level comprehension skills if your students don't even have the foundation. Again, you need to have, you need to know 90 to 95% of the words in a text or you won't be able to understand it. We can actually predict which students will be struggling and which ones will be strong readers by the time they get to high school by looking at their vocabulary scores in early grades. And clinically, not just in my research, I also found that a lot of those students that I was referring or that were getting referred to language therapy and that were ending up on my caseload were low in vocabulary. So the framework that actually helped me turn that around and get some of those students to their LRE, sometimes get some of them out of special education and help them be significantly more independent and do it consistently was actually honing in on vocabulary because that was the first domino. So the reason that that worked so well when I started to pull back on some of that comprehension work, started to stop worrying about getting to all of these social studies and science words that the teachers were giving me. Not that I was completely disregarding what the teachers were giving me, but I was, when I stopped trying to get to those high level skills and started to work on the foundation so that my students could actually comprehend at the word and sentence level, that's when my students started to make headway. So the reason that that worked was because I was treating the root cause, which was the basic comprehension at the word level. The reason that it actually worked was because I was focusing on fewer things instead of scrambling to get to all of it. And I was doing those things really well and I was treating the cause. So working on that actually improved that high level, those high level processing skills, because that was the cause of the problem. Before, when I was over here stating the main idea over and over again and drilling WH questions, my students just didn't have the foundation to be able to understand. So it was like I was repeatedly throwing them off into the deep end without teaching them how to swim. They actually made progress when I started teaching them how to swim. Because the bottom line is that students are not going to be able to comprehend entire paragraphs and summarize the main idea if they don't have solid comprehension at the word and sentence level. So if you're understanding what I'm saying, you're starting to realize that the culprit behind those comprehension issues was vocabulary. So that's why vocabulary is that first domino. So to review, the first principle was less is more. We've got to figure out how to get our biggest bang for our buck and not try to work on everything because we don't have time to do it and it's not necessary. And then number two, we want to figure out how to knock down the first domino, which is vocabulary. Now, here's a third principle. We have to make it meta because again, even when you're addressing direct vocabulary, teaching words directly, we can't teach students all the words that they don't know. And we need to give our students strategies that will help them to take what we've taught them in therapy and transfer it so that they're able to apply it once they leave the therapy room. So how we do that is we activate metacognition and metalinguistic awareness skills. So it's not just about teaching content and teaching words. We want to do it in a way that follows a specific process that is going to help students build those vocabulary skills on their own and be more aware of language and how they learn words, because that's what's going to help them learn on their own. So again, being meta, it refers to thinking or conscious awareness. When we talk about metacognition, we're talking about our awareness of our thought process. And when we're talking about metalinguistic awareness, we are talking about our awareness of our thought processes relating to language. So it's just a specific metacognitive skill. So if you have been listening to me and wondering, how is vocabulary the answer to all of these high-level processing skills that my students are having, how is it going to cover my bases when it comes to academic language? Well, it's because vocabulary, and this is something that I didn't realize, is more than you may realize. It's not just naming and identifying words like you have to do on some of the vocabulary tests. Vocabulary is way more than that. So when we actually have a set of protocols that helps us address the essential metalinguistic awareness skills relating to vocabulary, we are actually going to be able to really cover our bases when it comes to what skills your students need for academic tasks and high-level processing, and not just academic tasks, but things that they're going to have to apply in the workplace to be able to comprehend and process all of, you know, written language and communicate in writing and in oral language as well. So when we think about vocabulary, it's not just word naming. We want to think of it as a big, broad umbrella area with five key areas. So I'm going to go through all of those areas really quickly. We've got phonology, because we need to be able to have a phonological representation of a word. We need to be able to produce words and recognize words when we hear them. Without that, we're not going to really know a word and be able to use it effectively. So our concept of how words sound, all those phonemes together, and being able to recognize that ties into our vocabulary knowledge. So we want to make sure that our metacognitive strategies when we're studying vocabulary address phonological awareness and pull in that phonological component. We also want to be able to address orthography. So we need to be able to recognize and use words in print without a lot of without using a lot of cognitive energy. We want to be able to recognize them quickly. Without that automaticity, we're not going to be able to write and read effectively. Also, the spellings of words and the different parts of words with the way that they're spelled also gives us information about what words mean, as well as their pronunciation. So we want to be able to understand how spelling impacts words' meaning. So our meta strategies that we're using when we're dealing with vocabulary should also activate orthography and orthographic knowledge. This one ties into orthography and phonology, but number three, we want to also activate morphological awareness. We need to understand word parts and understand what they mean. So different prefixes, suffixes, grammatical endings. We need to be aware of those things because that's going to impact how words are spelled, how they're pronounced, and how they're used, and the overall meaning of the word. So that ties into vocabulary. We also need to understand the fourth component, which is semantics. So that has to do with the attributes of words and how they relate to what words mean. And then finally, we need syntactic knowledge. So we need to understand how words are used in sentences and how the other parts of the sentence give us information about what words mean. So when we think about syntax, you don't just want to think about those content words and how to use those in a sentence like adjectives, nouns, and verbs, but also the function words. Function words have to do with our vocabulary knowledge as well, like conjunctions and the other different parts of the sentence. So students have to not just understand what words mean, but also what words do. So that's why syntax ties into vocabulary. So in order to create that system that helps you knock down that domino and be super focused in therapy, we want to have a set of protocols that addresses these five areas. And you can have a couple strategies that might hit multiple areas at once. All of these areas impact each other. And chances are, if you're working on one, you're working on another because they're very interrelated and they're all related to vocabulary. So that is how you can start really focusing your therapy. And when you start working on these things, and when you have a system with a set of key protocols that you trust, that you know work, that will drastically cut down on your planning, it will drastically cut down on just the clutter that you feel with trying to figure out what to do next. And it also will cut down on the confusion, because when you have a set of protocols that you go through, you don't have to spend as much time planning in your sessions because your kids understand the strategy. And so you just cycle through those strategies and you just increase the difficulty level of the content as kids go up. So that's why you can use this concept and this framework from kindergarten all the way up through high school, and you simply just make the content appropriate to their age level. So That is how you can essentially get better results with less effort and really use that domino effect in your therapy. So knock down that first domino of vocabulary with those meta protocols that address those five components. And that is how you can laser focus on the right skills to get your biggest bang for your buck. Again, those five components were phonology, orthography, morphology, semantics, and syntax. And those three components for insanely effective language therapy that will help you cut down on the clutter and make more time for you so that you can actually leave work at a reasonable hour were the less is more principle. Focus on less, not more, and do it really well. Knock down the first domino, which is vocabulary, which again, those five components tie into it. And then number three, make it meta by having a trusted set of protocols. Doesn't have to be a ton of protocols. It can be just a handful of staple activities that you use and you cycle through with your students. So number three, make it meta. All right. So if you are listening to this, I imagine that you are an SLP who is again, treating pediatric language disorders. And you're probably starting to realize that you can actually make better results or get better results in your language therapy by addressing less, not more, if you do the right things. And you don't have to be like a superhero trying to get to it all. You can actually be a superhero by laser focusing, not overwhelming yourself, and instead helping your students make consistent, sustainable progress so they can get to their least restrictive environment. And so that you can position yourself as an expert, gain trust from your clients, your students, your coworkers, and eventually be really confident in your language therapy so that you can get the most fulfillment as possible out of your career. So if you found this video helpful, I would love it if you would share it with your colleagues. Thanks so much for watching.